Merry Christmas from John McMillan Presbyterian Church. I'm Pastor Jeff Tindall, and I am here to offer you Christmas greetings on this Christmas morning, the day we celebrate the nativity of Jesus, the birth of our Savior, Emmanuel, God with us. You might find it interesting, though, that historically, Presbyterians disapproved the celebration of Christmas because there was no and is no biblical foundation for the fact that Jesus was born on December 25th, at the time he was born. Even John Calvin disapproved of it because his position was, as was the rest of the early reformers that ultimately came Presbyterian, was that our salvation was entirely based on the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus and had really nothing to do whatsoever with his birth. I mean, not only was it the Christmas celebration a pagan sort of thing based entirely on what was called Saturnalia, the day when it was the longest night, and so the next day the days were going to get longer, the light was coming back into the world, sort of connected it with the idea that the light was coming into the world with Jesus. And so the reformers thought that because this Christmas day celebration of Jesus' birth was based on a pagan Roman celebration, they really didn't want to have anything to do with it. And they also believed that Christmas, the celebration of the birth of Jesus, the Christ Mass, was a Catholic sort of thing. And so the reformers who were trying to move away from the Catholic Church really wanted nothing to do with that either. Plus, during the Middle Ages, most people spent Christmas Day, you're going to be surprised to hear this, basically partying. And they would party for the 12 days of Christmas, which were the 12 days after December 25th. So we Protestants, very Puritan, particularly under Cromwell, decided that Christmas had no place in our world, and it was banned from 1647 until the mid-1800s in the Presbyterian Church. Interestingly enough, the banning of the 12 days of Christmas, the celebration of Christ's birth, created a great deal of unhappiness among the people who were even Presbyterian, and there were even riots in the streets of England when it was under the protectorate of Cromwell. And Christmas wasn't restored until the restoration of the monarchy sometime later. Meanwhile, over in the colonies, Boston banned Christmas from 1660 until 1681. And the reason they banned Christmas was for the same reason. There was just too much partying going on. There was just too much of what they thought were pagan festivals and things that simply didn't belong in the Christian church. But by the 18th century, well, even the Calvinists, even the Presbyterians, even the Puritans started to recognize something interesting on Christmas Day. All of the Presbyterians and Calvinists and Puritans were showing up at the Anglican churches for a little good tidings, for a little bit of great joy, and a little bit of Christmas celebration because they liked it. They wanted it. It gave them warmth. It gave them a little bit of peace. And so from that time on, even though we Presbyterians didn't like the party much, we aligned ourselves with the rest of the people and started to celebrate Christmas on Christmas Day with everyone else in the world. So that's my brief history of Christmas to tell you exactly why it is that we don't have Christmas services in the Presbyterian Church on Christmas morning. And we believe that the appropriate time to worship is on Sunday mornings because that's our resurrection day. But I do believe that there is a reason that we should celebrate Christmas and that we are sending out this message for you on Christmas morning. It's because Christmas is about something very important. It's about Emmanuel. It's about God with us. And God became part of humanity on that morning when Jesus was born, whenever it was, back some 2,029 years ago. And so it's not about Jesus just dying for us on the cross. It's also about God coming to us in the form of Jesus. Which brings me to one of my favorite Christmas hymns, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Let's take a listen. Well, now that we've harked the herald, listen to the angels sing, let's talk about the scripture reading that hymn is based on. It comes from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 2, verses 18 through 14. Listen to and hear the word of the Lord. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." That's the word of the Lord. That's the birth of our Savior. So in today's carol, we proclaim, "Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinner reconcile." This hymn is about our scripture reading. It is about what happens with Emmanuel. The angelic herald comes to the shepherds and provides them good news. It's a birth announcement. complete with location and identifying features, a Savior, a Messiah, the Lord. And there's a prayer. God be praised. May this baby bring peace on earth. Which makes me think about the little ritual we do on most Sundays. At the beginning of our worship services, we have a little ritual called passing of the peace. We spend a few minutes talking with each other around the sanctuary, shaking each other's hands, bumping elbows, doing the little fist bump, whatever we want to do, and we say to each other, peace be with you. Peace of Christ be with you. But why do we do that? I mean, there's plenty of time during our worship time on Sunday mornings that we're out in the narthex eating coffee or eating cookies and drinking coffee, talking with each other. We do that before the worship service. We do it after the worship service. So why do we need to have this little ritual of communication right at the beginning of our worship service? Well, it comes from Jesus. In John 14, Jesus has come to the end of his life. Jesus tells his disciples at the Last Supper, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you." Jesus passes his peace to us at that moment. Now, where does this peace of Jesus come from? Well, it's the peace we hear about in today's scripture, the peace that came with Jesus when he was born. It comes from the prayer of the heavenly host who were praising God and prayed this brief prayer for us. Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth peace among those whom he fears, whom he favors. A prayer of thanks for the delivery of Jesus and a prayer of intercession, asking that the birth provide peace on earth. The peace we pass in the worship service is the peace that Jesus brought to us when he was born, that he left with his disciples, who then passed it on to us over the centuries. And now we pass it to each other every Sunday morning. What that should teach us is that the peace that Jesus brings is not a feeling, it's a thing. The peace Jesus brought from God and passed to us can be passed from one person to another. And so we do that every Sunday. So what do we accomplish when we pass this peace? I mean, last time I checked, the world is not a particularly peaceful place. There's a lot of conflict in the world. But I'm not just talking about the wars that we have and the conflicts among the nations and the things that are driving our fears of global annihilation through some sort of giant war. I mean, there's plenty of that we can look at. But I think from a more personal standpoint, I'm talking today about the anxiety that I perceive in our congregation, in our country, and in the world generally. I'm pretty sure we all know what that feels like. All around the world, there are people worrying about so many things that are the same as everything else that everybody else is worrying about. Financial issues, familial issues, societal issues, political issues, social issues, religious issues. The everyday apprehension that arises from our complex and scary world that overwhelms us and crushes our spirits. So if Jesus has left us peace to pass, what could that possibly look like? What does it feel like? Well, I think it feels something like this. It is a mindfulness that even amongst this scary world that we live in and the anxieties that it causes, Jesus is with us. God is with us. Emmanuel still is present. This is the gift from God that we get at Christmas. The peace came when God came to be with us. So when we pass the peace, we are offering a prayer that the person we greet experiences God's presence, a sanctuary, even brief, from the unease of life, even for just a moment. And I think it might look like this. Some time ago, I read a book written by Richard Foster simply called Prayer. In it, it describes a time when he was anxious and he was harried and he was troubled. He was looking for a bit of peace, and so he began to pray all by himself, "Rest, be still, shalom." And he repeated those words until the rest and the stillness and the shalom overcame him, and the anxiety was gone. His troubles were, he was able to put away, and his concerns about what he was doing in life became less acute. It was a calm, a feeling of well-being, he describes it, an awareness of something more important and profound than his anxiety. He called it God's presence in the midst. The presence of God in the midst of his life. And it helped him through his anxiety. Not long after that, I went on a mission trip as an adult chaperone with about 65 high school kids at a church I was attending at the time. We spent some time in Agua Prieta, Mexico, but our base was in Douglas, Arizona. And on the last day we were there, we rode from Agua Prieta to Douglas, and then from Douglas to a little church in a community that was close to the airport where we were going to fly home from. And that evening, while we were getting the kids bedded down, so to speak, in the church, somebody got sick. And I remember the pastor who was with us on the trip said, "Boy, I hope that doesn't burn through everybody." Well, it did. In the course of about 4 or 5 hours, we had to take probably half of the kids that were with us on that trip to the hospital emergency room because they were so dehydrated from the virus that was clearly burning through everyone on the mission trip. It was a pretty anxious time. And there was one particular young man who I knew pretty well who was very sick and was very anxious. And so we ended up taking him to the hospital. And I sat with him in the emergency room while he was waiting to be treated. And he got more and more agitated the entire time he was there. And so I didn't really know what to do. So I prayed a short prayer that I often pray when I'm meeting with someone providing pastoral care, as I say, "God, please give me the words that this person needs to hear right now." So when I prayed that, remarkably enough, immediately after that, I thought of Foster and this vignette that he provided in his book. And so I had this boy look me in the eye and I said, "Repeat after me, rest, be still, shalom. Rest, be still, shalom." And he started repeating it with me. We said the words together, we said them together for about 5 minutes. And both of us got very calm and he ultimately fell asleep. One of the other chaperones who was on the trip had observed this event, and he looked at me and he said, "I've never seen anything like that before in my life." And I looked at him and I said, "Neither have I." And what I realized at that moment is that I was experiencing the presence in the midst. We were experiencing God's presence in that moment through those words that had been provided to me by someone else. It was the peace of God. I inherited that peace from Richard Foster, who inherited that peace from God, and I passed that peace along to this young man. It was something that was really, truly remarkable. One of the other times I experienced this, I think many people did at the same time, and it was something that we can't forget, is back in 2001 at the tragedy of 9/11. I remember I was the managing partner at a law firm in Pittsburgh, and we just heard about this event. We pulled it up on the television so we could see what was happening, and then saw the news people from Pittsburgh saying that there was one plane that was still out there. Nobody knew where it was, but they think it was near Pittsburgh. And we thought that Pittsburgh might be a good target for this plane And so we were told to basically evacuate downtown Pittsburgh. And so I told my staff that they should go. And after everyone was out of the building, I sat in my office and looked out the window. And if you remember, it was a beautiful day, the bright, sunny sky, totally blue sky. And I prayed because I didn't know what was going to happen. But I knew whatever it was going to be bad. And I needed to figure out a way to get through this day and the days that were going to come after it with my staff, with my family, with my children, with the people around me. And so what I did is I prayed for God to give me that peace, that stillness, that shalom. And then on the way home, I found out that I wasn't the only one who was praying that day, because when I stopped by my church, there were a lot of people there. And we were all praying that somehow peace would come despite this tragedy that had occurred that day. That's the peace that we get when Jesus is born. That's the peace that comes to us with the birth of Christ. I want to share one final story with you, which I think is important. The German pastor and theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer had been arrested in Nazi Germany back in the 40s. And he was imprisoned in a concentration camp. And he wrote a letter to his fiancée, a woman he never got to marry. But I want to read to you what he said in that letter. "Be brave for my sake, dearest Maria. Even if this letter is your only token of my love this Christmastide, we shall both experience a few dark hours. Why should we disguise that from each other? We will ponder the incomprehensibility of our lot and be assailed by the question of why, over and above the darkness enshrouding humanity, we should be subjected to the bitter anguish of a separation whose purpose we fail to understand. And then, just when everything is bearing down on us to such an extent that we can scarcely understand it, the Christmas message comes to tell us that all our ideas are wrong. God is in the manger. No evil can befall us. The God who is secretly revealed to us as love rules the world and our lives." I love those words. God is in the manger. That's the kind of peace that I sought for this young man in Agra Prieta. That is the peace that I sought for myself after 9/11. That is the peace that Bonhoeffer sought for he and his fiancée in the 30s when Hitler was trying to take over the world. That is the peace that we get at Christmas time, and that's the peace that we celebrate on Christmas morning. That is what the heavenly host prayed for at Jesus' birth. Peace on earth, goodwill toward men, good tidings of great joy. And that defeats the darkness that enshrouds us. And it is the peace that God passed to us when Jesus was born. And we can feel that peace this morning. No matter where we are, no matter what we're doing, on Christmas morning 2023, rest. Be still. Shalom. Merry Christmas. Hark the herald angels sing. Glory.